So today we are going to start with module number 6. So just to quickly summarize that what all things we have done in the past week, we have completed till module number 5, and in module number 5 the flow that we have followed and understood is that we initially explore that what are the key data sources that we have. Maybe we could say the base stations from which we can extract the data. So we have understood in combination in module number 2 and in module number 3 that how we can extract and along with that transform the data. So we have seen and we have used sources like RDBMS database, SQL, and some of our Excel files, some of our CSV files, just to get the data from the data source. And then we have followed some of the transformation techniques just to clean and prepare that data so that after this, we have seen that how we can, in module number 4, how we can easily load it into my data model. So load the data in the model. So from here, basically, the important things, or we could say the critical, we would say the process will get started, because getting data into data model and after that shaping that model is something which is important that we have understood and we have seen very effectively that if my model is not appropriate or if the tables inside my model are not communicating with each other in a relevant manner through relationships or maybe we could say the cardinality, then in that case the effective data rendering on my visuals will not going to take place. So we have understood all these things. We have seen this thing, how to manage the relationships, how to manage the structure of the tables when we get the data inside the data model view. And followed by that, we have understood that how we can enhance the structure of data model by implementing the DAX expressions in module number 5. After this, we understand that once we implement the DAX expression on module number 5, depending upon that which storage mechanism I am using in order to store my data, whether I'm using the default import mode, or probably if I could say I'm using the direct query mechanism because I am looking forward to a voluminous data. All these factors, be it a DAX expression or maybe the storage mechanism, they definitely make a very relevant impact onto my data model. So the sixth module that we are going to understand is how we can make sure that my data model is performing up to date, how we can tune our data model so that it will help me to create and build a dynamic, or we could say a better reports. So before actually getting into report creation, that is in module number 7, we are going to talk about this module number 6 today. So when we are going to understand that what all do we have inside module 6, so basically we'll be talking about majorly how we can optimize the data model for an effective performance of my end product, that is my reports. So basically we understand that generally the optimization or maybe the performance tuning is highly dependent at the source level. And that is the first area, or maybe we could say the place where my performance tuning has to take place. So we understand this thing in a way that when we have to tune or when we have to manage the performance for my data sources, here the Power BI developer has to do nothing. Here the database administrator, or probably we could say the data engineer, is going to take care of all the stuff that my hardwares and my platforms are readily available, because if by any chance we are connecting through direct query. So all these things have to be up to date. My data availability has to be there. Proper backups have been taken. Disaster management recovery needs to be performed. So all these stuff, all these performance tuning stuff need to be managed at the data source level. Now, at some times that there are certain situations that arise that we have to manage performance tuning, or maybe we could say we have to optimize the things at the Power BI level also. So when it comes to managing things, or we could say when it comes to optimizing at Power BI level, then we generally start with data model, because they are the backbone. They are the base onto which my reports are created. So for an instance, if my reports are taking longer time to load, the visuals are taking longer time to load the data, or maybe whenever we were interacting with the elements, the others are taking maybe we could say time longer than the usual one just to interact, just to cross highlight, or maybe we could say filter. So in this situation, the best place where we can optimize, where we can start optimizing, is something that is my data model. So when we say optimizing at Power BI, that is something talking about optimize the data model. So we, in this module, are going to talk about some of the best practices that Microsoft itself suggests that my data model can be turned up to a kind of a shape. It can be changed into a kind of a shape where it can run more efficiently. Because if my data model is optimized, the overall performance of my Power BI report is going to be effective. So I hope, sir, the agenda is clear that what we are going to cover in module number 6.
Yeah, sounds good.
Okay. Now, when we talk about the best practices, so the first thing that Power BI suggests is that whenever we are writing the DAX expression, it is good to use variables. Generally, in every programming language, we did not only DAX expression, any other, we generally say that optimized usage of variables is something which is really very effective, because if the variables are properly declared, they are properly managed, they help us to basically perform two things. One, it is actually reducing the query, or maybe we could say the expression length. The overall length will get reduced. Another thing is it will help us to troubleshoot the thing very easily by any chance if it is required. So we say troubleshoot. So in case of troubleshooting, variables will be very effective. In case of reducing the size, or maybe reducing the size of the expression, maybe an underlying DAX expression, that will also be effectively managed when we are going to use the variables. So this is the first thing that we may can go for. The second and the very important thing that Power BI suggests is use its optimization tool. So when we say optimization tool, and that optimization tool of Power BI is a performance analyzer. This is performance analyzer. Now, basically, we'll be going to talk about that this performance analyzer, or maybe we could say the optimization tool, help us to do what? It helps us to gather the stats, or maybe we could say the metadata. We understand, sir, what is metadata?
Yes. Yep.
Great. That's great. So when we say the metadata, we talk about that relative information which usually will not come into picture. So the hidden facts or hidden information which help me to understand my data more effectively. So this optimization tool helps us to gather some statistics, or we could say some logs or meta information, which will help us to understand, identify the bottlenecks which might can arise inside my reports, and further they may can act as the roadblocker. So we may can use this tool, and we will be going to see that how this tool is going to help us to capture all these logs or meta information, and how we can study them, and on the basis of that, what are the changes, probable changes, or that we can make inside a data model, or maybe inside my DAX expression, just to optimize my overall structure of data model. So understanding this thing, that optimization tool. Then we'll be going to talk about and understand reducing the cardinality. So when we say reducing the cardinality, we'll be understanding here that if we are working with the object, or maybe we could say the data model, which is bigger in size, it will definitely going to cause us, or maybe it will going to cost us plenty of resources. So we need to understand this thing, that how we can reduce the cardinality. There are many ways through which we can reduce the cardinality, because when we get the tables, we generally try to prepare relationship among those tables which are relevant. So relevant relationship management has to be there, because it will in turn help us to get the effective data from the reports. Apart from that, it is every time recommended that we should go for aggregations. We should go for summarization of tables. So because if we have big tables, management and understanding of that big tables is really very typical task. So it's a good choice. It's a good thing. That is why we generally go for creation of measures. Because when say measures are talking about summarizations. Measures are talking about aggregations. So that is why reducing cardinality or reduction of cardinality is being implemented or maybe suggested by my Power BI. Apart from that, we could do some changes in the PBIX files also, by saying that we are managing the queries and we are reducing the queries. So generally we could say when we have to manage the Power BI files, we follow something or some strategy which is known as a query reduction. Now when we say query reduction, this is the process which helped me to send less number of queries to the resources or maybe to the engine just to get executed. So we'll be going to look forward to this technique also of Power BI, that how we can reduce the number of queries that are being getting sent to the resources. So we'll be understanding this module, and we'll be going to talk about some of these best practices in detail now. So let us just start with the use of variables. Let's just understand that how we can use the variables. So let me quickly share the screen. The PowerPoint presentation. So in this, we are going to understand that how we can optimize the model performance, or maybe we could say the data model. So as we were just talking about, that data model performance optimization is something which is really very important, because sometimes what happens when our report run, it is running very well in the testing and the development environments, but actually the challenge came in the production when we are going to deploy it for the broader consumption. At that time, the performance issue arises generally. So from the perspective of a user, when we say my report is actually giving poor performance, it could be the report pages are taking a longer time than the usual one to get loaded. The visuals are taking a longer time to being getting updated. So all, obviously, we could understand this thing, that all this poor performance is going to overall result in the negative user experience. So that is why we say that we should optimize the data model. So we should optimize the data model just to ensure that the correct data types are used, to delete the unnecessary rows columns, when we say deleting the unnecessary rows columns, this is something we were talking about. We were reducing the cardinality, avoiding the repetitive values, because when we have repetitive values, unnecessarily what happened, it will give me a chances to have, we could say, bulk data on my page, on my page level filters, that is known as R slicers. Reducing the cardinalities, analyzing the model metadata through performance analyzer. So all these steps are going to be involved when we say we are optimizing the performance of our data model. So the first one is this, use of variables. Let us just understand this with the help of one example, sir. So they say that they were just trying to write a DAX expression, which is helping us to find the YOY, that is year on year growth. So now how we can measure growth? When we have to measure growth, the basic formula we understand that they are applying is that this is their sales, their total sales, or maybe the active sales that have. And then obviously, if I am planning to find out the year-on-year growth, then I am looking forward for my last year sales also. So this is my sales of, we could say, previous year. This would be my previous year sale. And we have to again divide it by my sales of previous year. So basically, this is the logic that we are applying. Now, when they were writing the DAX expression without variable, what is happening? The sales year-on-year growth is being getting calculated, where we have written first the divide function. Now, in the divide function, this complete expression is the numerator, that is this one, and followed by that, this one is the denominator, the one which is highlighted with just a blue marker. It's a denominator. That is my previous year sales. So what we are doing, this is sales minus, this is actually the previous year sale that we were talking about. This is that previous year sale. So now, this is the complete expression that they were writing every time, just to avoid this repetition. Because if by any chance this huge expression will lack with any comma, or maybe any bracket, or maybe anything that is definitely going to cause an error in the complete DAX expression, because it is doing what? It is calculating the sales. This is again a function of my DAX parallel period. The parallel period is the period corresponding to which we have to calculate sales. So we will be calculating for minus 12 months, that is past 12 months, complete 1 year. And the same expression we were again writing. So just to avoid this, just to avoid repetition of long statements, or maybe we could say expressions again and again, they say we can go and use the variables. So here in this expression, we are using the variables. We say, just assign this complete long lengthy expression to a variable and then reuse that variable wherever you want to use. Just to avoid confusion, just to avoid the scope of problem, or maybe we could say errors. And obviously, this is not mandatory that I am the only one who is going to use this Power BI file. Maybe any other Power BI developer is going to peep into this particular code. So when we write expressions using variables, it will help the other developers also to understand the code and the written logics effectively. Isn't it, sir? So this is the overall idea behind using the variables. So let us just now see. We have created a data model. Let us just now see that how we can write the code, or maybe a DAX expression, using a variable. We'll take this example only, and we'll see how these variables are going to look like inside my DAX expression. So I'm quickly coming to my Power BI desktop, and this is that data model itself on which we were working last time. And I have just quickly make a copy of that data model and named it as my performance data model, or my performance data model I have named it as. Now what I'm going to do is I am going excuse me, I'm so sorry, because since past 2 days I'm really very having a very sore throat. So sorry for that.
No, if you need to get a drink of water or some.
Yes, it is there. I'm in between just sitting. Actually, last year I was down with COVID, and at that time there are two things which I have simultaneously happened to me. One is COVID, and another one is that chronic laryngitis. So because of that, my throat has become very worse, and I have to be on medications generally at times. And when I skip those medicines, and I don't know what happened, this allergy has came into my blood after COVID. We have got tested, and my pulmonologist has concluded this thing that we could say post, these are all post effects that I was having after COVID. So there are certain things which has got entered into my blood, because of which I have just been prone to allergy. So I have to every day take the allergy tablet. If I'll not take it, then this is something that happened. My always get worsen, and the sore throat and all these problems.
COVID is, I mean, I've seen some of the pictures of the damage it does. It's scary stuff.
Actually, sir, because I have seen, as in around me, plenty of people, they have infected and they're very well now. They have been recovered. And I don't know, although there is no problem, I understand. But yes, this is something that you have to keep on meditating yourself. You have to be on medicines, and there are so many restrictions. You can't do this. You can't eat this thing, nothing. So even after handling and taking all the precautions, still this thing has now entered into my blood. So I can't help it.
Yeah. At one time I had double pneumonia, and I was in the hospital for like 9 days. So I get it. Yeah. No, it's, you know, or sometimes, you know, sometimes stuff hits us. You know,
yes, actually. Okay, so let us quickly add a measure on this fact table. So we will be adding a measure, and we'll be calculating the YOY growth. So let me just add a measure, and I'll be using the same example that we were referring to in the slide, and we'll be saying this is the sales year on year. Growth that we have.
So how do you bring that up? Like if you were to close that, how do you bring that back up?
This one, sir? The DAX window?
Yeah, I was struggling with that. It's like,
no problem. Let us just do it once again. Let me close it from here.
Well, no, I know how to create the
measure. I'm saying that that for any measure, if we have to open it again.
Okay, yep.
So let us just say we have created a measure last month's sales, for an instance. So yep. This is the measure we have created. So when we click on this, this window appear in front of us.
Well, yeah, mine, maybe because I was doing stuff in that and I closed it, I wasn't sure if I was, is there any way to bring that up without clicking off and clicking back on?
As such, we could say that correspondingly any button. So as of now, we can't see until unless we'll not click the measure.
Okay, that's what I was looking for, is a button to pull that formula thing back up.
Yes, because other than that, when we click on the measure, what will happen automatically, what happened, that DAX window will appear in front of us.
Okay, but there's no way to dock that. Like,
no, you know, sir.
Like,
there is no way to pin that thing so that we can just simply go to that, push that button, and get that window in front of us.
Okay. Okay. That's what I was looking for, is some way to pin it or something.
Okay. All right. So let me just write that expression that we were just about to write. Yeah. done. Where is my measure? Okay, so we'll be calculating and we will be using here the variable. So just to come into the next line, we know I have just pressed shift and enter. So when I have pressed shift and enter, I have come to the second line of this DAX, writing the DAX expression in the second line. So we'll be using a variable and let me just say, we'll be using sales of previous year. This is my variable name. So it should be, we understand, like all programming languages suggest, variable name have to be sensible. It has to be, it should not be that much of abbreviated so that other people will not be able to understand what it is actually. So we have to name it with a very, very logical understanding. So,
okay.
Sales of my previous year, and how we have to do it, we have to calculate it the way they are calculating. So we'll be calculating.
Then, yeah. Now, does this have a REM statement? Can you put comments in these or no?
Yes, sir, we can do that.
Okay. I'm just wondering, because like a lot of programming languages, you can actually put like...
Yes, these are all just like expressions. As in, if you want to put a comment, you can do that thing.
Okay.
All right, so we will be saying that we will be calculating this one, total sales, and that we have to calculate for a parallel period, and we have to give dates here. So this is my date tab, date column. We have to calculate it over a period of minus 12, and then we understand month, quarter, year. So we're looking for the month. So this is, we have to calculate. Let me close it over here. And let me come to the second line. So now this is the variable that we have used. And after that, for an instance, let me just say the calculation which we were doing, that is also, we'll be saving it in a variable and then we'll be returning that variable. So let me say this is my, or we say sales variance. And what it is going to do, it is going to use a divide, and within the divide we have to take what, we have to take the numerator. So I'll be just quickly putting another bracket here, and my numerator is going to be the total sales that we have minus the sales of my previous year. You can see, sir, this is the variable how it is going to show inside the DAX. So this is my sales of previous year which I'm going to use. Perfect. Once I'll close this, this is my numerator, and after that, the denominator. What again, it is going to be the sales of previous year only, the logic that we have used. Then putting up a bracket here, and finally doing what? Finally just returning my sales variance. This where we have just saved the reference of the calculation that we have done. I'll enter it. For an instance, by any chance, if any line that you want to comment, sir, for commenting, we have to put, just a second. When we put at the beginning of the sentence, it will become a comment. For an instance, like this, we want to do this. See, sir.
Oh, but it's leading in that direction, not the other direction.
Sorry, like, sir, I've just lost you in between. Could you please come back again?
Oh, yeah, no, I was thinking that reminds me of like C comments or something.
Okay, as of now, we do not have, sir, any, so that we could see the comments. Otherwise, if you want to comment any line, this is the way we used to comment. So there are plenty of ways. Yeah, so okay. this is the way through which we can comment.
Okay, all right.
Okay, so let me quickly create this measure, and let us populate it on a visual where we could see how much growth is being getting done for the data that we have. So let me take a table. Let us just say for year, if you could see. Don't summarize, it must be getting summarized. So don't summarize it. Okay, so year wise, I want to say that growth. Okay, so if we could see, we have two more things, I believe, with us. One is, okay, we can just put this total sales. And we have, this is the last one, sale, I believe we have. Last one, sale, the one. If you could find out the last year sale, then we will be able to understand this thing, that how the trend is being moving. So this is the total sales that we have. And if we just quickly use one thing here, this is the overall growth. We could see for 2 years, there is no growth actually, sir. Use one more visual here. Let me say this is my last month's sale, and I could say here this was last month. If I could use the previous last year, and here is what previous month we use previous year.
Yeah, where I worked one time, they had all of these types of reports in this Access database. Mm-hmm. And one that they really liked and they wanted was a year to date with year to date from last year.
Yes, but that is YTD, MTD, all these things, sir.
Okay.
That YTD is year till date, MTD is M month till date. These are the things that we have.
Okay.
So we can calculate them here also, as in we can write the expression and we have month till date, year till date, just like we have previous year, parallel period, these functions. Similarly, we have all these functions also which are available.
Yeah, it's weird because I'm going through these examples going, I've looked at this so many times. Not because I didn't do the programming underneath the hood, but I looked at the results so many times. Mm-hmm. That when I see the results, it's so familiar, but I didn't know how to get to that under the hood, which that's what this is really cool, is you're actually showing me how to construct it under the hood. I looked at these databases for like 15 years, so
so by this we can just simply add the things, analyze, and we are good to go with the things. We will understand that why it has happened last year, and we can just manage it to have total sales just below it. So this is my last year sales and this is the total sales, and if you could say current year, so we can understand why it is being getting into negative. This is positive, there is a good growth, whereas there is a huge dip. overall, this is the growth that we have year on year, whatever we have. So the major, we could say, idea behind doing this particular demonstration is just to show you that if you are planning to create this year-to-year growth, then we understand that we can simplify the expression by writing or introducing the variables. Isn't it, sir?
Yeah. That makes sense. I mean, simplifies your life.
Yes.
Good sense.
Okay. All right. So let us just move back to the PowerPoint presentation. And now we understand this, the performance analyzer. So we understand that this performance analyzer, where it is located actually, when we go to the view tab, in the view tab, inside this, we get this performance analyzer. So we can see that this performance analyzer tool is accessing our report's performance and identifying the areas for improvement. So this is the major thing that generally we use before deploying, or maybe we could say before publishing the reports to Power BI services. Because once they get on Power BI services, I am ready with those reports that I am ready to collaborate with my team, with my group, with my people, which are looking forward to that data in the form of visuals. So before actually giving this hand holding to them that, okay, this thing is ready for use, now you can use and make the better business decisions. Just before that, we have to ensure that my report is giving me a good performance. So that is why it's a good practice just to run the performance analyzer and try to identify the bottlenecks by any chance if they are, and we can improve them. Just to get rid of the negative user experience that we have been landed up all because of the problematic issues. So now let us just see how we can analyze this. Because when we talk about performance analyzer, we were talking about that the metadata, or maybe we could say the statistics, or probably we could say the log that they generate and that we have to study in order to analyze the bottlenecks, all of them will give me the information in 3 P's. Now, when we say they are giving us the information in 3 P's, so those 3 P's of information is, one is related to the DAX query. It is going to explain us that how much time, because when we talk about the statistics or the metadata given by the performance analyzer, it gives us that how much time my each component inside the report is taking. And this is usually in milliseconds. So how much time my DAX query is taking, the time that is took for the visuals to send the query, along with the time which it took to analyze services has taken and return the result. So everything is going to be in ms, milliseconds. So time taken by the DAX queries, then we could say probably the time taken by the visuals to display the data. We may can say there is one more component, that is other. Now, when we say visual display, this is the time that has been calculated, which is taken by the visuals to render the data onto the screen. So generally, if we have some web images, probably for an instance, we have included some web images, or we'll be having some streaming data that we are going to talk about in module number 8 very soon. So how much time they are taking to render onto the reports and maybe onto the dashboards and all those things. So that is really very matter. And when we talk about others, this is something all the rest of the components, which will not came into action, but actually they're working at the background. For instance, the time taken by the visuals to prepare the query, time spent by the visuals in order to wait for other visuals to complete. Or maybe we could say there are some background processing tasks that are required to be performed whenever any DAX expression is keep on loading. So all of them in cumulative, whatever time that they are spending and taking, that is something is the part of the other component. Okay, so let us just see one example set. Then we'll be going to relate with all these things, that what this DAX query is all about, what this visual display, and what this other, how we will be able to see all those things. So for this, what we can do is, let me quickly say, I have a Power BI report with me, or maybe I could say this is a page that we have that I have created earlier. Now on this page, what I have is I have just three tables that we have taken from my Adventure Work 2020 database. These are the things which have been come from the database only. Just to make sure, let me go to the transform data and see the data source settings. If I see the data source setting, the data source of the current file, if you could see, sir, it's localhost, that is my server, and the database is Adventure Work 2020. Okay, sir? So now,
yes, I see it.
Okay, so now when we have got this thing, I can see easily that there is only report and a model window, there is no data window. What does it conclude, sir? If I do not have the data window just to view the data, that means
you're using a connection. You're not, it's not storing it. It's not caching it locally.
Yes. And it is termed as, or it is named as what?
Direct query.
Yes, absolutely. And how we can see that thing, how we can make sure there are just some tricks just to identify whether my data is imported or it is direct query. When we go to the data model, sir, if my tables are highlighted with blue color, this is something which shows as I am getting the data through direct query. And here we could see, sir, the storage is direct query. But let me take you to the other file which I was just working with. In the data model, here you can't see such kind of color code. Yes, we understand that while rolling over my objects also, I could understand the storage mode. It is import here. And in case of this one, I could see it is my direct query. But just by looking the data model, I can easily understand that it is my direct query because these this blue color. Another thing is, when you come to the report section, sir, here you see at the extreme right down, the storage mode is what, sir? It's direct query. Can you see this thing over here?
Yep. Yep.
Yes. So this is how we could understand that this is being got through the direct query mechanism. Now, let me say these are the three tables, and using these three tables, what we have done, we have created a small report which is giving me sales by month for a specific year. For instance, for 2020, for 2021. So how it is loading? For 2019, we have 2018, we have. So this is how it is giving me the data. Now what we have to do here is, let us just say, let us come to the view option now, and let's see how my performance analyzer is going to work. So let me open this performance analyzer and let us study it now. Let us just see what it is going to have. When I open this performance analyzer, my performance analyzer readily is not going to give me anything. It says, start the monitoring of your report or maybe the elements and find out the details about how much time they are taking. Whenever you are getting the data through the queries and they are ready to render the data onto the result pane, or maybe we could say through visuals. So we have to start this monitoring. We have to start it. So let me just do one thing. So let me just start this recording. They say your recording has started and now you have to interact with your report. So either I can interact with my report, probably, or other than that, I say, let me just quickly refresh my visuals. let me refresh my visuals and let me just say how much time it is taking when I refresh. So when I say I'll refresh the visual, can you see, sir, we have two options here. One is related to slicer and other is related to sales by month. These are the two things we could see.
Okay.
All right. So now when I see this slicer and this, as of now, don't save. What happened? Produced abruptly. Let me open it. There must be a bug inside this Power BI desktop. Because of this, it has happened. Okay, let me open it again. Again, trying to connect. Why it is evaluating the queries and trying to reconnect? Because the storage mode was direct mode, sir. It was not import, because it has not loaded the data locally anywhere in the cache. So it is evaluating those things. And let me check. Let me go to the data source setting and let me just change the source. There's a different server name. It has detected automatically. No problem. Let me just do it. Say OK. Close. Light changes. It's ready again. Perfect. So let me quickly go back to my view. And I've just clicked on performance analyzer, started the recording, and just refreshed the visuals. Now, when I refreshed the visual, I could simply go and expand my slicer, this one, and my sales by month. So here I could see, sir, the DAX query, timing that is being taken by DAX query, timing that is being taken by my visual display, and other. There is one more option that is related to the direct query which we have. You could see here the direct query, because the data is as of now being captured by, or maybe is being getting rendered through the direct query. If by any chance I say that let me change it from, instead of direct query, let me make it, because I am using a previous version of Power BI. Let me just check, sir, whether I have that dual option available with me or not. So let it be like this only. We'll keep it like this only. I'll come to my data model. I just want to show you that if I am directly querying the data, and by any chance, if I change the storage mode to import or maybe to dual that we used to have earlier, how it is going to affect? How it is going to affect overall the time that is my queries are being taken? So just to make things a little easier, let me take a snip of it so that we can be able to compare it. Perfect. Now let me come to the data model, and when I come to the data model, and let me say for date, it's direct query as of now, and I can change my storage mode. Can you see, sir? I have this dual option available as of now with me. Great.
Yep. Yeah, I can see it.
So let me say, see, sir, when I'm trying to change the mode, can you see that it is being highlighted with a yellow border as well as of now? And let me change the mode. Let me say dual. Let me just do it. And I say, okay. Let's see what will happen. I'm not directly making import. I'm just making dual. Can you see, sir? The solid line has got broke on this date. It is not as similar earlier that we have for product and reseller. Now, the storage mode, we could, yes, that has got break. Now, the storage mode, if you could see, it has become so dual. So now, after doing this thing, after changing the mode, maybe the dates that we are rendering, can you see, sir? This data tab has came once again because it's not purely direct query as of now. When I go here, the storage mode, can you see, sir? It's mixed.
Okay. Yep.
It's mixed. Now, what I'm going to do is, let me just say, refresh the visuals once again. Let me refresh the visuals once again. And when I refresh the visuals, I could see here inside my sales by month, which is earlier taking in overall 321 milliseconds. Earlier, the direct query is taking, can you see, sir, here? The direct query is taking 134 milliseconds. Now the query is taking just 50 seconds.
Okay.
So these are some of the effects. And how we got to know about these things, they will actually not come just an instant. We have to get into these things. And yes, with keep on having a good view on all these data and understanding this data, we'll be able to find out this conclusion, when to go for direct query, when to go for import mode, or probably we could understand, it could be an example. For an instance, let me just show you one more example, how to change my DAX expressions, because there are some times when we'll write a DAX expression and those DAX expressions are taking a little longer time. For an instance, we could see in the slide that they have shown us one example that they are counting the customers. They were counting the customers. They have created a measure actually here. And how they are calculating or maybe counting these customers, use the calculate function, and then they're filtering the context of data. So they were just calculating the products. And every time they were calculating the products, they were saying that the order quantity has to be greater than or equal to 5 that for that particular product. This is a simple logic. So we'll be doing what? We'll be counting the products. And every time when I have to count a product, I need to check that corresponding to that product, the order quantity that I have, it has to be greater than or equal to 5. So what is happening over here, sir? If you could see, corresponding to this expression that is written over here, the statistics that is gathered by my performance analyzer, it is showing that they have just highlighted this DAX expression. Nothing else. They said that DAX query is taking this much of milliseconds, 2754. It's a huge time, sir. It's huge time. What is happening? Every time for counting the products, for calculating the count of products, they are going and checking for the order quantity greater than or equal to 5. What we can do, instead of filter, we say, let us just replace with keep filter. Let's replace it with keep filter. Because keep filter will do what? We understand every time we have to not make a round trip to my table just to find out the product. This has to be there. My order quantity has to be greater than or equal to 5. So we just keep this filter instead of every time checking this filter and see, sir, what is the effect that this change in the DAX query has made to the time consumption by the DAX query through my performance analyzer. From 2754 milliseconds, it has just reduced to 54. Right?
Yeah, that is really good.
So that these are all, we could say, the things which are available inside that. That is why I have shared that DAX guide with you. That we have so many of functions. We have so many of functions, and actually the time doesn't allow us to discuss all of them. But yes, why keep on working with all of them? We understand when to use which DAX function or maybe the filter expression in which scenario. Because overall, if my DAX query is taking this much time using this filter, that means they are making so many round trips onto the data source just to render that data. That means the visuals are definitely going to take a longer time to display the data later on when they are going to publish on Power BI services. So how my performance analyzer actually helping us? So they were logging the information in this way that we have just seen with the duration of the each task that taken to complete. And this duration indicates that how my every element of a report, Power BI report, is taking a time just to get familiarized with the resources. So we have to understand this thing. We have to understand and we have to find out the behavior of our data, which is there inside the data model. And accordingly, we need to optimize it. Okay, sir?
Yeah, no, that's good.
This is something that the concept we have of performance analyzer and how it gives us the data. And the moment, let me just say, I'm going to stop it. If I clear all this data and if I'll stop it, again, it will stop, we could say, collecting the meta information or the statistics. So whenever we have to get that stats, gather that stats, we have to start the recording. And then accordingly, we have to work with the report and then analyze that meta information that we have. We can do that. Let me just close this performance analyzer and let's go ahead. So this is something we were just talking about, reducing the cardinality. So basically, it is a good practice, and we generally do this thing that when we were creating a data model, in the transformation step, we do column profiling. This is something which is helping us to understand that column distribution and column profiling. How many unique values do we have? How many distinct values do we have? We have to understand this thing, and we have to find out the bestest way through which we can reduce the size of the tables. We can perform the aggregations so that the summary data is going to be there inside my tables or maybe inside my data model. Because when we have summarized data, it is taking less of the time, as in it will take less of the efforts, probably we could say, just to build the reports, and in turn the performance is itself going to be optimized. So reducing the cardinality is something which is recommended by Power BI to us. Perfect. So what do you think, sir, that what is the benefit that you are getting from analyzing the metadata that you have just seen through that performance analyzer tool? What was the benefit?
What benefit do you get from analyzing metadata? I know we just talked about that. I mean, you're able to see where the bottlenecks are.
Mm-hmm.
You can optimize the performance.
Absolutely, sir. So the main thing is that when we analyze that log, we can just find the anomalies. We could find the bottlenecks, or maybe we could say the inconsistencies, which will help me to understand which direction or which way I have to proceed. You have to change the storage mode. You have to make some changes inside my DAX expression. It will very, really, very clear, because all the components are highlighted in a very specific manner. The DAX is there. The query is there, the visual time is there, the other time is there. So we can see which component is my resource eating component. We can work on that and we can optimize the overall performance. So well said, sir. Totally agreed that yes, just to identify the bottlenecks and we'll find the direction where we have to proceed to optimize my data model in a better way. And which tool we were using to identify all these bottlenecks?
The performance analyzer.
Perfect. It's performance analyzer. Yes. And here again come, we could say, tricky, but actually not a tricky question, that what is cardinality?
The uniqueness of data.
Yes. Or maybe it could be the directionality also, the direction in which data flows in the relationship between the tables.
Okay. Yeah.
Yes. So optimizing the data query model, which we have just seen that we understand that there are so many benefits that when we are connecting the data through direct query, it is being bringing up, because we understand this is one of the way where we could easily connect to the data source directly. We are not requiring to cache the data at the local system, but at par sometimes, along with all these benefits, there are some, we could say, the drawbacks also which came in action. And those limitations are, we understand the performance of my report is totally dependent upon my underlying data source. For an instance, if my source is unavailable at the time, my direct query will not be able to connect with the data. If we have just seen that when we have opened up that Power BI file, accidentally my Power BI file has encountered some other server instead of my local host. So it has just promptly given me the error that we are not able to communicate with the SQL. Because I'm totally dependent upon my SQL and my server and my host. And if they are not reachable, if they are not communicable, then it is really very difficult for me to get the data. So all the modeling, all the transformations, they are in turn totally dependent upon the underlying data source. But yes, there are benefits. We are close to the real-time data. We have been supported by accessing the large volume of data which is available inside the database. But yes, everything comes with pros and cons, isn't it, sir?
Yep.
So we need to understand that when wisely we have to choose this option, when to go for direct query, and when we can change it to import depending upon how it is performing with the help of performance analyzer. So this is something that we were talking about, that how we can reduce the number of queries. We were talking here how we can reduce the number of queries that is being sent by my Power BI file to the resources through this query reduction. Now, this query reduction is actually an option. This is an option which is available inside my Power BI file, current file options. So let us just see this. We'll see how this query reduction is going to actually we could say work in the Power BI. Then we are going to talk about it in detail. So let me come to my Power BI file here, and let me quickly say my performance data model. Let me open it once again. And we are now going to see inside the options. The concept of query reduction. So it is opening. Close this. Okay, since it has not saved, so it has opened just my that page, no problem. Let me say, do we have a visual here which we can use? Okay, let me just create one small example here with the help of which we can view the query reduction. So for an instance, I say, let me use, do we have order quantity? Yes, we have order quantity and remove color also. So let me search for order quantity. Here's my order quantity. Let me use, and then color wise, if I want to view the order quantities, so great. Let me go down here, enable the data labels. So these are my order quantities, and why my order quantity is coming in K. Yes, we have this and this count is one. And the count is this. Okay, so let's just do it till zero and let's see. So these are the number of, as in this is the order quantity that we have. Okay, sir. Now let me just see. We have this filter option. We understand this is my filter, which is in combination of the visual effect and the page level filter. Now I say I want to filter out this visual on the basis of the color black. When I select black, this is the first query that has sent to the resource for filtering the black color. When I say blue, the second query. And when I say green, this is the third query which has sent. And along with that, I say that the count of order quantity, let's say, has to be greater than, I say, 10. And then again, I say apply filter. Let me say, it is less than 20. Because of this, let me just do one. Clean this one. Let me clean this one. And let me say, let me quickly create a measure of this just to find the product. Just to show you this example. Or maybe we can go with this only. Let us just only apply the filter on colors itself. So we were just saying that whenever we were selecting the colors, every time it is making the selection. Now, I want to combine all these queries. As of now, there are three queries which I have sent to the resources just to filtering the data. Now we say, instead of doing this thing, let's go to the file and within the options here, we have something known as query reduction. So when we see query reduction, what is actually happening, sir? For our slicers and filters, instantly when we apply the slicer, any change to the filter or maybe the slicer, it is instantly applied. Now, when I have to reduce the queries, when we have to do the query reduction, we have to do this one. Add a single apply button to each of the filter that you are, or maybe to each of the requests that you are planning to send to the resource. So when I change it to a single apply instead of instantly, let me say okay, and let's come back here and do the selection for the color. Let's say black. Is it getting changed, sir? The way earlier it is being getting changed every time for every color?
No.
No, this time, because it is capturing all my requests, putting them into cache, and when I'm going to have a single click on this apply, then it is going to filter out my data. Now, the three selections or maybe the three distinct queries which I have made, they have been combined as a single query and sent to the resources for being getting executed. This is how we are reducing the number of queries, or maybe we could say the round trips that we are making to the data or probably to the resources. With this also, we can optimize the data.
So it does it dynamically or on the fly?
Generally, what happened that if I am not managing this query reduction, for every query will be an individual query. It will be acted as an individual query and it is going to the resources, doing the filtration and probably coming back with the outcome. So we could say we can reduce this thing. So we have to manually manage it, just like that time intelligence and other settings that we used to do inside the Power BI file. For an instance, for data load, we have time intelligence, we have relationship. So these are all the auto managed things. Similarly, for my query reduction, we have to change it from instantly to this option so that we can reduce the number of round trips, or probably we could say the queries that is being getting sending to the resources.
Okay, that makes sense.
Great. So we understand that when we have to optimize the performance of my data model, and in turn, yes, obviously my reports, which are my end product, we can use performance analyzer just before publishing it to Power BI services to get the log or maybe the meta information. We should perform the optimization, or we could say we, being a Power BI team, we can't obviously perform the optimization at the data source. This need to be taken care by the database administrator and the data engineer, that my data source should be properly optimized. At Power BI level, we can only do this thing. At my BI level, I can use the performance analyzer. And we can do what? We can use the query reduction. So instead of instantly, we could change it to apply, add a single apply button so that we can overall reduce the round trips of my queries to the resources, just to make the things in a better and correct shape. Okay, sir. So some quick questions. Which Power BI option is giving you this opportunity that you can send fewer queries to the resources?
I'm trying to remember the actual name.
Let me come back to the previous slide. This is what?
Oh, query reduction.
Yep. Yes. Yes. It is query reduction. Other than Power BI, what is the optimal place where should be focus on optimization, performance optimization? So we understand that we can optimize the performance at Power BI level using performance analyzer, using variables, or through query reduction. But what should be the prime location where we actually do the performance tuning?
The data source.
Yes, absolutely correct. It's the data source, because that is the prime location which should be speaking things in a proper manner and proper language. Otherwise, we will definitely going to face challenges at the Power BI end. Okay, so what do you think, that is it possible to create relationship between two columns if they are different data type columns?
I think so. I think you can, but it'll cause unpredictable results.
Absolutely correct, sir. As per their answer, they say no. But okay. But in practical, it is yes. Correct. You can create, but it doesn't make any logical sense. Because if you are creating a relationship between a department ID, which is a numeric type, with the department name, or probably with the job ID, which is of the DEX type, then there is going to be no logic of creating that relationship. And we have understood this thing just initially that when we are optimizing the data model, it says reduce cardinality, reduce the unwanted relationships which are actually don't require to have inside the data model. Unnecessarily relationships may lead you to circular relationship or probably the relational dependency issue related to data model. So all of these things should be avoided.
Okay.
After this, we need to understand that how we can create and manage the aggregations. Now, when we say aggregations is a technique when we will be somehow breaking a huge table or maybe a structure into a smaller chunk or maybe a granule. So when we say we have a huge table with so many rows and columns, just to get a summary of that is something which is known as aggregation, because we are overall compacting the structure. Our prime focus is to reduce the size of the data model. That is overall going to be there. And more than 25 to 30% questionnaires actually in the Microsoft DA-100 examination come from this section only. That without increasing the size of a data model, how we can do this thing? So that is the prime focus, because if my data model is compact, then everything is going to happen with great ease. So we understand when we say in aggregation, we are actually tending towards reducing the table size just to improve the overall query performance. So how we will do that thing? We do this thing with the help of the group by technique. When we say group by, let me just give you one example, sir. I hope you'll be able to relate with this. So when we need to manage when I have to manage the aggregations, for an instance, I say that I have an employee table. And inside this employee table, I have employee ID, then employee name, then the department, and the salary that we give to the employees. Now we understand within this employee table, we may have several employees reporting to a similar department. For an instance, we have so many of them working in IT department, so many of them working in sales, admin, and all these things. Now, I want to reduce the size of this big table and to make it compact. How? I want aggregation value. This is something my non-aggregated table. I want an aggregated approach where I say that I should get relevant thing. I need department ID and what is the total salary that is distributed in each and every department. So 10 in 10, maybe there is the department ID 10 that we have, that is admin department. How much salary we have distributed to people working in 10? Then 20, those who are IT people, how much we have distributed to them. Then 30, maybe salespeople, how many which we have distributed to them. So what is happening here? For an instance, if we have somewhere around maybe 250 employee record here. And those 250 employees are working in just 6 departments, corresponding to 6 departments that we have. So when we do the aggregation, in aggregation, what will happen, the number of rows and columns automatically going to get reduced. That is why what we are seeing here, the size of my output table that we are getting after aggregation is being getting reduced. And how we are doing it? Through group by. We are grouping the things. We are grouping it on the basis of a logical column department. And what we are grouping? We are grouping the salary. We are just creating a sum of it. I hope this is giving you an idea about aggregation.
Yep.
Okay. So let's just perform this thing practically. Let's just see how we can perform the aggregation. So for that, let me say.
But it makes sense because, like, we produce seats for GM. Mm-hmm. Or General Motors, and we get a bill code, which is like a string of characters. Mm-hmm. And that string of characters is literally the recipe for the seat. And so it's like they've done all this beforehand and looked at every option, you know, heated, non-heated, you know, what row, what side. And they basically just give us, you know, I think it's like 20 characters long. And that represents the entire seat, the color, the fabric, the style, all of the options. And so instead of sending us all of the data, like, you know, like.
They were just giving you that key just to decode the actual product name.
Yeah. For every single vehicle, we get that one line thing for each seat, you know, and, you know, probably 4 to 5 seats. But it's so tight, it's so compressed that they can send an entire. Yeah, they can send an entire day's production in just a small file.
This thing actually resides in database, sir. I'll let you know one thing which is out of the scope, but yes, it is really going to be very helpful. For every table inside a database, when we talk about RDBMS databases, there is a pseudo column. And that pseudo column is something which is known as the row ID, sir. Now, this is a hexadecimal key which we have for each and every row, and a database administrator, just by looking this ID, can easily decode this table belongs to which file, this row is in which block, what is the amount it is consuming, each and every piece of information which is going to be there. So it's a hexadecimal key, and through this key it is really very effective in terms of indexing, effective in terms of viewing the data, effective in terms of when by any chance the table size is getting increased. When it increase, we generally in databases have a concept of row chaining and row migration. So that this is the head which is having the complete info. It will be there inside the base location itself, but the rest of the parts are moving here and there. They're migrating, or the chains have been created. So you'll be able to just got information about this header itself. That is this power of that magical key that you were talking about. I can totally agree with that.
That's interesting. Okay. Yeah, that makes sense. I've never seen that, but that's cool. Yeah, that makes complete sense.
So because when we were reducing the things, we are overall compacting the structure, which is definitely when we have small things, they're easy to manage, easy to work upon, and we're just looking for the summarization of the data. That's it. Instead of roaming in this complete big table within 250 rows and just fetching the data out of it. So yes, definitely. Aggregation is going to help us to create in turn a great and impactful data model. So how we can do this thing, let us just see. Okay, so let me say, let me come to this file only. Let me see if we'll be able to perform here. Or I come to my performance data model itself. Let me save this. And let me come back to my transform data. And when I say I'll transform the data, I'll come back to Power Query Editor. So where I can perform the aggregations inside my Power Query Editor. It is just a kind of a transformation step itself. So we can see this, that we have this group by option, which is available inside the transformation only. So now what I'm going to do is, let me create a duplicate of this fact table. Now we have two options. One is duplicate, another one is reference. In terms of Power BI, when we say that we are duplicating any of the query, we were actually creating a new query with all the existing steps that the previous query is having, just to perform some, maybe we could say, testing part that we want to do. And this new copy will be completely isolated from the original query. Whereas when we say we are referencing the query, this is a new copy with only one single step that we are just referencing it from the current point or location. And yes, we are directly looking forward, we could say, to the original query. So it is recommended inside Power BI that whenever you have to do some testing transformation task, go for a duplicate copy, don't create a reference one. Okay?
Okay.
So let me just say duplicate. I say duplicate because I'm going to perform the aggregation on this duplicate copy. Now, when I come on this, I am going to name it as, for an instance, let's say this is my sales aggregate table. So I'll do the sales aggregate. And now what I'm going to do is, I have so many things here. Order date, ship date. Okay, let me go to the columns and we can pick some of our point of interest. So let me say order date I want, and I want order quantity, sales amount, product, or let it be like this. Let's work on these things only. So let me say okay. And what we are going to do is, on this order date, I'm going to say group by, and we will be counting the order quantities, and we'll be overall doing the sum of the sales amount that we have. So which operation? The sum of the sales amount. And let me say okay. So when we do this thing, corresponding to every order date, what is happening? The number of quantities are being getting counted and the sales is being getting summed up. Can you see, sir?
Yes.
It has not reduced the number of rows actually, because we have done it on the basis of order date. Let me show you on product if I would be able to. Let me make a duplicate copy here also. And let me rename it quickly as my product aggregation. And we say that let us do it on the basis of color. Let me group it by colors. So, or maybe let me just group it on the basis of the categories that we have. So on the basis of categories, we will be counting the subcategory that we have. We'll be counting the products that we have, and we will be doing what? We'll be counting color, and finally we'll be summing up the cost. So if I do this, I could see the real effect, where the size has been reduced in a very effective way. So we have these four categories, and in this category we have 35 subcategories, and corresponding to that we have 35 products of 35 colors, different colors, and sum of cost is again 35. No, it has gone something other way around. Let me just redo it, because it has just counted all the things. Let me make it on the basis of color. Let's say on the basis of color, I have to count the product, And I have pushed some. I believe some I have not done properly in that cost. Some I have not done properly. That is why it has turned out like this. So here we go. So we have total 129 black color products, and this is the sum of the cost. We have total 56 green color products. This is the sum cost that we have. So this is actually the aggregated we would say. And what we can do is, when we say close and apply, and this data will be loaded inside my data model, after that I'll be able to manage these aggregations very effectively. So if we could come here, and let me just see, these are my aggregations, and any of the aggregation I can manage the aggregations. So how we'll be able to manage them with other tables that we have. So we will be able to manage the aggregations with the help of this. So I hope, sir, this aggregation is clear, that how we are compacting the overall size of our table or maybe object.
Yeah, that makes sense. I never looked at it that way, but that makes a lot of sense.
So we will be creating aggregation. So when we have creating aggregation, actually the best way or maybe the finest approach is just to determine the grain. When we say grain is that level on which you have to perform the aggregation. For an instance, in this example, my grain is this. This is my grain. My level on which I have to perform the aggregation. On the basis of departments, I have to find the sum of salary that is being distributed to each and every department that we have. This is my grain. In this example, we could say the color is my grain. On the basis of that color, I have counted the number of products and find out the, we could say, the summarization of the cost related to the products that we have. So this is my grain value. So we have to understand that grain, and accordingly, we can further manage the aggregations. So what is we could say a critical aspect of data aggregation that is allow you to focus on when we are aggregating the things? We are actually focusing on what?
I don't know. I'm sorry.
No problem, sir. So when we say that we are aggregating the data, we basically say that we are focusing on the meaningful information. Here, when we say why we have chosen this as a grain and doing the summation of salary, why we are aggregating the way like this, because this is the meaningful information basically which I am looking forward to, that maybe later on I'll be using on my visualizations. So whenever we'll be aggregating the data, we will be every time focusing on the most meaningful and logical information that I really want to derive from the big table. And yes, we'll be aggregating it. I hope this makes sense.
Oh, yeah, I was thinking you were asking for a term.
Oh.
That's why I was like, I couldn't think of a term. I was like, I don't remember a term. But yeah, you're focusing on the, like, kind of like when you're doing that with dates.
Yes, this is something about what actually it is allowing you to do, what it is allowing you to focus on.
Okay.
Just to find the meaningful information, the most important and the meaningful information. And before we actually getting into creation of aggregation, what is the first thing that we should decide?
What is the meaningful information?
Yes, what is the meaningful information? On what basis we have to do the aggregation? As in, we should search for the grain. Maybe the column, or we could say the candidate attribute, on the basis of which we are planning to perform what? We are planning to perform group by operation. Right?
Okay.
Yeah. So find the level or maybe the grain on which you want to create actually what? To create the aggregation.
Okay.
Great. And with this, we have completed the module number 6 as well, which is talking about how we can optimize the data model in a very effective way.